All right, so in this video, we're going to look at the small intestine, right? So in fact, if we're looking at the gross anatomy, if you all remember, gross just means sort of large anatomy of that. So it's the major organ of digestion and absorption. If you guys remember, the small intestine is where a lot of the magic happens, like we said, and that's where most of your absorption occurs. So you can't live without a small intestine. In fact, if you start thinking about disorders of the small intestine, they often affect your ability to absorb, which means you could get malnutrition. So you start thinking about things like Crohn's disease or like inflammatory bowel disease, then you can see malnutrition as a result of that if it affects the small intestine significantly. Okay, so it's 2 to 4 meters long from the pyloric sphincter to the ileocecal valve. So 2 to 4 meters would be anywhere between like 8 to 12 feet or so. That doesn't sound like a lot, but that's because in a living body, it's kind of in a contracted state. But in an unembalmed cadaver, after the person's died, the muscle relaxes in the small intestine. And through that relaxation, it ends up doubling in length and size, right? So you find that an unembalmed cadaver, their small intestine is up to 20 feet long. But in a living person, it's 8 to 12. And so it's not super long, you know, if it's as long as there's muscle contraction there. We can divide this, though, into some divisions. We have the duodenum, the jejunum, and the ileum. And if you guys remember, the duodenum was mostly retroperitoneal. If you all remember retroperitoneal, like Park DD, it was behind those digestive organs. Okay. The jejunum here was attached posteriorly by mesentery. So remember, mesentery proper holds the jejunum and that part of the small intestine in place by anchoring it to the posterior abdominal wall. And then the ileum is also attached to mesentery. But the ileum is the distal part of your small intestine that links up with the first part of your large intestine through a little region called the ileocecal valve. We'll talk about that. So if we look at this here, we've already talked about the oral cavity and the associated salivary glands. We talked about the pharynx and how that constricts to force the bolus of food down your esophagus. Remember, the esophagus goes behind the heart. In fact, the heart sits right here, which is one of the reasons why this part of your stomach is called the cardia, right? The stomach then leads into the duodenum, which right here is the first part of the small intestine. Now, this first part of the duodenum is actually retroperitoneal, so it's not completely surrounded by peritoneum, just the anterior surface is. But the duodenum actually forms a sharp bend. Like, you can't see it here, but it forms a big old U-bend here, kind of like a P-trap and a drain, like below your sink. And the purpose of this bend in the duodenum is that it traps that chyme as well as the digestive juices that are released in the duodenum, and they sit there until they're digested. And then once muscular contractions can force them along, then that food is forced along that bend and then to the rest of the small intestine. Okay, and we'll see this bend a little bit better. The problem is that the colon is in the way in this picture. Okay, the duodenum is also over here. So it goes all the way and wraps around over here. And then we eventually reach the jejunum. And the jejunum kind of circles its way over and eventually kind of makes its way over to the ileum. So you guys see this last little segment here is called the ileum. And the ileum is what links up with this large intestine. So you can see the large intestine right here and the vermiform appendix hanging off. But what separates the small and large intestine is actually a sphincter called the ileocecal sphincter. And there's a one-way valve too. We'll come back to that here in a little bit. So here's the duodenum. The stomach would be here, right? And so remember, here's that big old U-bend we talked about. It's kind of like a P-trap and a drain under your sink. Have you guys heard of that? Like maybe like if you drop your ring down the sink and there's not a little catch, it can get caught in that U-bend or the P-trap. That way you can still get it as long as more water doesn't force it through. And so it kind of makes sense that your body has something like that too. Because imagine if chyme enters this little U-bend, it gets trapped right here temporarily. And that way it has time to mix with the juices that come from your gallbladder and your pancreas here. And so we call this the hepatopancreatic biliary system, okay? Or basically the system of bile and pancreatic juice that are co-released into your duodenum. And this is what takes part with the digestive aspect of your small intestine, okay? So one of the functions of your liver is to make bile. And bile is effectively an emulsifier of fat. So what that means is it breaks fats into smaller bits and helps it increase the surface area for digestion. And the way this works, you guys, is that bile is made by the liver cells here, hepatocytes. And they eventually find their way through a system of little ductules that meet up here, and they form the right and the left hepatic ducts. So the right hepatic duct drains all the bile that's produced by the right lobe of your liver. The left hepatic duct drains all the bile that's released by the left lobe of your liver. And then when those come together, we form something called the common hepatic duct. Okay. Now the common hepatic duct goes all the way down to this one here called the cystic duct. But once the cystic duct, which attaches to your gallbladder, meets up with the common hepatic duct, we form a new one called the common hepatic duct, right? I'm sorry, common bile duct, rather. So all of this is the common bile duct, which goes all the way down, 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 and then it meets up with the main pancreatic duct. And they form a shared space here called the hepatopancreatic ampulla, or the ampulla of Vader, right? So what happens then is that bile juices mix with pancreatic juices in this little area right here, okay? But they're held there until you need to release them, because there's actually a sphincter right here called the hepatopancreatic sphincter, also called the sphincter of Oddi, right? Is that even up there? No, it just says major duodenal papilla. Oh, here's a sphincter right there, right? So this is gonna be constricted, and you're not gonna release pancreatic juice and bile juice unless you're in the intestinal phase, right? If you're not in the intestinal phase yet, then these are held back. Now what happens then is that bile then backfills, and it goes back, 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 and it keeps filling back until it goes back into the cystic duct, and your bladder stores that excess bile, the gallbladder rather, right? So your gallbladder stores that excess bile here, and that way if you do ingest a lot of fatty food, you have excess bile to emulsify that fat, right? So the gallbladder doesn't make the bile, it just stores it for later use. Now the way you get bile from the gallbladder down here is that you actually have smooth muscle in the wall of the gallbladder. In fact, you guys remember that hormone released by the small intestine called cholecystokinin, or CCK? That actually stimulates the gallbladder to contract. The vagus nerve stimulates the gallbladder to contract, but more weakly. But CCK is the major hormone that really causes your gallbladder to just go and squeeze that bile down the cystic duct, down the main bile duct, towards the hepatopancreatic ampulla, or ampulla of Vader, right? Now, we also have pancreatic juices that are made by the pancreatic acini, and those actually drain through the main pancreatic duct, and they actually exit at the same spot, which is pretty cool. So you co-release bile and pancreatic juices in the duodenum, and that mixes with the acidic chyme. Now, if you guys remember, is the duodenum adapted for acid? Do y'all remember that? It's not, right? Exactly. So what we need then is that bile juices and pancreatic juices need to be slightly basic or more alkaline, because what they do is they actually neutralize the acidic chyme in your duodenum. And that way you don't burn the duodenum with stomach acid. That's a good thing, okay? So if we look at the wall of the small intestine, this helps us explain how most absorption occurs there, right? So if we look here, we see those layers. We got our mucosa. We have our submucosa. And back here we have the muscularis and then serosa or adventitia, right? Now, what's different, though, about the inner lining or mucosa of your small intestine is there's all of these folds. We call these folds the circular folds or the plicae circularis of your small intestine. Now, what this does, though, is it increases the surface area inside of your small intestine, okay? In fact, on these folds, there's even more folds, if you guys look at that. So all these little smaller folds sticking up are what we call the villi. And each villus is like a small extension of the mucosa sticking up off the surface, right? So let's zoom in just on this little area here, right? So now what we're looking at is on one of those folds, right? On the surface of those cells, or I'm sorry, on the surface of those folds rather, all of this is a villus, and villus means shaggy hair, okay? So all of this here is a villus. In fact, these are the simple columnar cells that line that villus. And if we zoom in on those simple columnar cells, those even have more folds, which are the microvilli, right? So here's the thing. We got folds on top of folds on top of folds, and then some microvilli. Okay. So what's the first fold? Well, it's the intestinal fold. And you can see that with your naked eye, the plicae circularis, okay? And then the second fold would be your villi, which stick up off top of that. And then this is shown in one villus here, right? And then on the villus, we have simple columnar cells that, if you zoom in on this, has a microvilli brush border. So it's even more folds on the apical surface of those columnar cells to get even more surface area. In fact, if you measure the total surface area of your small intestine, you guys, it's something that's on par with like the size of a tennis court or so, right? So there's a tremendous amount of surface area locked up in your small intestine. And the way it works is that you have lots of folds, right? And so the purpose of this is that by having all that area or surface area, you can absorb a lot, right? More surface area, more absorption. And this is really one of the major things that contributes to the absorptive ability of your small intestine, okay? By having all that area. So what if you had a disease where, let's say, like inflammation or something, where you had so much inflammation that instead of having all these folds, it kind of filled out and it smoothed out, right? So you had a smooth kind of surface there instead of all these folds. What would happen to the total amount of surface area in your small intestine? Would that be greater or less? Less, right. So if you have less absorptive surface area from inflammation, you're not going to be able to absorb as well, and therefore you could be malnourished. And you see that with conditions like Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis or inflammatory bowel disease. Just less surface area available for absorption. So keep that in mind, you guys, as you move forward in other classes like pathophysiology. Okay. So remember, microvilli here on the surface of these cells also are adaptations of the membrane, plasma membrane, for more absorption. And if you look inside the villi, we see there's lots of capillary beds and lymph. So what types of nutrients were absorbed into lymph? Do you guys remember? Lipids. Good. So lipids, which would be like cholesterol, free fatty acids, even fat-soluble vitamins like K, A, D, and E, those are absorbed in lymph. And what was that fatty lymph called? It's my name, right? What's that? Kyle. But it's spelled differently, right? So Kyle, which is the fatty lymph that you absorb along your intestinal tract, is C-H-Y-L-E, right? But that goes along your lymphatic system and then drains into your bloodstream kind of up here by your subclavian veins. But we'll come back to that when we get to the lymphatic system later, okay? And then everything else is absorbed in these capillary beds within the villi, okay? So if you're talking about like, minerals, water, or carbohydrates, or protein, like that's absorbed, or water-soluble vitamins, those are absorbed into your bloodstream rather than lymph.